for years and years, I struggled with probably one of the most frustrating elements in my life. Granted, my life, I guess, is pretty easy compared to some, but it was how to deal with low end in guitars. And one of the guys, the guys that helped me through this was Joe Perry of Aerosmith. I was listening to Eat the Rich, and which I've used as a reference track for a million years, probably since I started this. For some reason, I always thought that particular song just sounded awesome. And I noticed that the differentiation between the electric guitar and the bass was astounding. But without being wimpy, it still sounded really powerful. But those guitars, for sure, are high-passed heavily. Or at least they just don't have low end messing it up. And, I guess I could just play the damn thing. I have it right here. Is that legal? Yeah, section 16 says you're good. All right, listen to Aerosmith here. I'm going to pull this down. All right, I got the bullcrap intro. Let's turn it up to full volume here. Listen. Okay, and what you noticed right there, great reference track again, is that these guitars have no low end in them, and they don't sound wimpy to me. Maybe they're kind of doing a classic rock, Aerosmith type of sound, but I don't hear anything crappy and cheap. I feel like if Dimebag Darrell played the same riff, I mean, it'd be his tone and his thing going on, but I don't think I would. And so that's something that's plagued me for years. And I kind of come to the conclusion one day when I was just goofing around and being extreme, which is about the only way to ever get any better at this gig, it seems like, just trying stupid stuff. I got this little stupid saying that when doing it right doesn't work, then just do it wrong. And it's stupid, but it has bared fruit for me for sure. Okay, now that I'm going to look like an idiot comparing my mix to Aerosmith, let's go back to my electric guitars on this kind of half country, half hard rock mess we've got here. Okay, and we can already tell, now that we just cleared our ears with the Aerosmith track, there is no denying it that we still have quite a bit more 200-400 merc in here, in our mix here. Now, I don't necessarily think we have to copy Aerosmith, and that's something that when you're dealing with reference tracks, you always have to be aware of. It's real tempting to just go ahead and like carbon copy it that, like it's a stencil or something. And that doesn't work if you're trying to say something different. And so I don't think we're in bad shape. I mean, I don't think it would take a lot of work to find other reference tracks that would have about a similar amount as what we have here. So basically, I'm happy with this. What's funny is how did I get to this conclusion? First of all, I didn't really understand what we were doing whenever we started this project. And so guitar tones kind of were just shot in the dark. We just kind of threw something up there until it stuck. And I liked this tone, but it may not have been what I would choose now if I knew exactly where we were going to end up. But I'm cool with it. But here's what's funny is I'm not even really close to the Aerosmith clarity in the low end and how much space they've given the bass and the drums, which are both very, very powerful in that song. But here's what I had to do to get there. Let's see. This thing says it's at 215 hertz, -6. You never know what. I don't see a Q reading. This is part of Alloy's thing. I wish they had a few more numbers that I could kind of spit out for you. I do know it doesn't look like the low end stops dropping off until closer to 400 or so. 320 is right there, and we're down 2 decibels at 320. So anyway, I had to make myself aggressively do that right there just to get to the sound we were hearing. Now let me bypass this EQ entirely, and let's listen to our guitars as I track them. First, let's solo them, because that's always fun. Okay, and I want to point out, this is the Axe FX, and I was told right about the time of I was doing this one, this particular project, tracking it. Some guy was talking about how the new emulator gadgets like the Axe FX just don't have the beef and the low end as the real amps. And I kind of snickered a little bit whenever I kind of made the Aerosmith discovery, I'm going to call it, and realized I had way more low end than Aerosmith on my guitars anyway. And this whole low end beef business is the biggest lie since, I don't know, some kind of, military-industrial complex conspiracy thing. So anyway, it's clear that that is not our biggest problem in life. And for guitars that don't go vroom, we have, in my opinion, I think it's fairly safe to say almost no reason to have anything under 200 hertz in them. At least I say, almost, as in we could just shelf it and pull down 10 decibels or something. I don't know. Maybe just a high pass in general. And what I've noticed is as I've done more and more guitars like this here of late, what I'm calling it the throwing copper tone. I don't know how many of you guys were big on live throwing copper. It was, went diamond, I think, in 94, give or take. And one of my favorite records of all time. But the rock sound of guitars, they're not pretending to be metal. There is no, in there. They don't have this low-end business. And on their more rocking songs, which weren't so much on the radio, there isn't a live quality. Like those guitars, when they go, Zoom! And you can tell it's done in with a matchless or some kind of vintage-y boutique kind of amp. That's what it feels like anyway. I don't really know what it was. But what I've noticed is that sound you can actually get with an open-back cabinet. And you can get it by just high passing aggressively so that you're emphasizing just that, that rock frequency, if you want to call it that, where you don't have all this kind of like phlegm and snot just dulling up your guitar tone. And this is a tricky business, and EQing never seems to be a great way to get guitar sounds. This is something you kind of need to do on the amp, but it's a concept that, the Aerosmith concept that needs to be dealt with in your tones. And so let's kind of play around with EQ just a little bit on this track in context. And I know about where I'm at, so we could go way further. Let's see what happens if we do. Just kind of chasing this Aerosmith thing, kind of experimenting. Basically just trying to find ways to make our tracks rock way harder. And maybe being a little skeptical of low-end and guitars for a little while. And let's just see what we come up with. Okay, right now it says 4007 hertz it says minus 6 there. I don't know what that means, but you never know with these shelves what they're really kind of doing down here. But when I go down that far, it says minus 10. So we're definitely knocking off a lot. Let's keep on going. All right, watch this. Mr. Bass, you are on vacation. I have it says 576 hertz. That is on, right? Let me make sure I'm not an idiot. Bypass the EQ. Okay, if that's not the most telling sign of why so many home recording guitars are awful, including a lot of my own, I think this sums it up. listen to how much crap in the low end is in there. I mean, it's not even subtle. This is something we have to get serious about, dudes. Like, I'm getting pissed about it. Like, why did I not do this video to myself 10 years ago? I'm kind of ticked because I've been fighting guitar tones and always frustrated with the low end this, and maybe my small rooms contribute to it. I don't know. I've always, my brain will go and try to find a million freaking answers why, you know, I've got all these great amps and great mics and preamps and all this junk. Why did I never just hear pretty good guitar sounds high passed at 576 hertz? I mean, I've done this before with tones that maybe were flawed in one way or another. And I think I really like the sax effect stuff for the most part. So, well, not even for the most part. I really like it, period. But before, and that's not an issue of sounding big. That just, it just sounds like fat. Like, not with a P, just like, you know, lipids, like fat rolls, and cottage, yeah, you know what I'm talking about. All right, so now with this EQ on. We lost no size at all. It's easy whenever you're AB to like one or the other. You get that whole drinking orange juice with your pancakes and syrup problem where, you know, your brain gets confused. But by comparison, but if we listen to just these guitars and you imagine a guy on stage and he sounds like this, what do I complain? And I'd say, hey, it sounds like a good guitar sound to me. And again, this is not metal, and we're not doing, but we have a bass that can do stuff, and in metal we do too, by the way, in case you didn't know that. I struggle with that sometimes. But let's keep on going and see how far. I did not expect to get up to 576 hertz without us freaking out. Oh, hang on. Ah! Whoopsie. That stupid vocal probably won't make the final mix. Ignore him. What's weird is now that we've gotten rid of a lot of the fat off our guitars, the bass actually needs to be EQ'd too. It actually has a little bit of some of that 200s junk. It needs to be kind of going in the Aerosmith route too. It's like the bass was all dumb and tubby and getting away with some kind of lie, and the stupid guitars were kind of covering it up. Well, now the guitars have squealed. Get it? Anyway, guitars are telling the truth. Now we can see that their buddy was in on it too, and he's not. He's also muddying everything up. All of this is making for small kick drums, by the way. Another thing is we're going to be skeptical of everything. This is just how I think and how I learn new stuff, by the way, and how I get better at all this stuff. We got to be careful if we keep moving in this Aerosmith direction, because that Aerosmith production may not make sense on every song, although I think what we're doing here does feel right to me. And attacking the bass is particularly, not really muddy, but dumb sound. We might put ourselves into a hole that, or, you know, into a corner that doesn't make sense for this song and stuff like that. So we always got to be skeptical of both ways. Let's be skeptical of the old way, but also let's not just throw out, you know, the kitchen sink. Does that apply? No. I like messing in these things up for some reason. I'm going to blame it on lack of sleep. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and we'll start a new EQ, so I don't have to look at that one. That helps me. And we are going to mess around with this bass a little bit, too, just to see where we end up. Because I do think something's a little silly here. All right, we're listening. Ah! And there's the idiot. 159. At least that's what the headphones tell me. I'll trust it. We'll stay kind of broad, although we maybe won't. Might want to tighten that up. Well, let's just see what happens here. I don't know. I'm still going to play here, but there's other issues going on with this bass that are beyond the scope of this thing, but I just wanted to see what happened. I'm going to leave that particular new cut there. 10 decibel cut at 160, boys and girls. Didn't expect that. This mix already passed the test, both in the on the monitors and in the computer speakers. So what I had before may had been a perfectly workable setup, and I might have just messed it up. But either way, just going back to these guitars, I want to see how high I can go until they start sounding wimpy. Okay, I'm at 720 hertz right now, fellers, and I don't hate this at all. If I heard this mix, assuming my headphones aren't lying to me, and I don't think they are in this particular case, then we're in good shape. This is something that, I don't know, REM or Counting Crows or, you know, some band like that that had, like, gain every once in a while on their stuff. This is kind of more the route they had. I mean, it doesn't sound like Linkin Park or anything like that, but that's the riff mostly, I think. There's a part when he goes, wow! That still sounds like waddle to me. Nothing about this sounds wimpy. So anyway, keep going. I do want to point out that I am hearing a weirdness, or it's starting to get a little bit bitey, and I don't know. I'm going to find it. Probably 5, but it could be as low as 3. My ears aren't so good at that stuff, but let's find it. Alright, that hurts pretty bad. Let's see. I don't know. Now, EQing guitars is notoriously problematic. But I just want to experiment here, and I want to kind of show you guys what I'm up to. Okay, and so what's happening now is I'm starting to hear other problems that maybe the low-end stuff before was helping to kind of cover up a little bit, which kind of like with the bass problem. Now I'm hearing some just inherent bitiness in the tone that it might be possible to EQ out, but I think that's going to be a real pain in the butt and not the kind of thing I'll have to spend too much time on. So I'm probably going to be stopped right here at whatever I stopped at, 780 hertz. But the point here is that most people are probably, and that's me included, are recording their guitars with just too much damn low end. They need to have, and some of that is the level that we guess that the guitars will be in the mix. When we know we're going to have them way cranked up, there's a tendency to hear all that harshness and pull it back down and go, ooh, that's too small sounding. But when we know they're going to be a little bit lower, well, we've got drums and bass and vocals and all this other business to fight, well, we can get away with a lot bitier tone because I need that to cut. And I do remember, I've read it multiple times. What's that guy's name? Clint? Mike Clint, maybe? I'm pulling that out of my butt here, and it's getting late for me. But I think it's Mike Clint. Anyway, the guy that, he did Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction, and a bunch of other famous stuff, too. He was in the Spring Chicken when he did that one. Anyway, he's always said he takes a 57 and puts it on the center of Celestians, like on guitar speakers, 412 cabinets and stuff. The center of the speaker on a 57, you know what that sounds like? It sounds like the worst thing imagined. Like, it hurts. So I think we're going to have to do some experiments and find out there's something to this. Take a regular, whatever that means, good tone, record with it, regardless of what our monitors are really telling us in terms of bitiness and all that crap. And bring that up in a real mix and see what happens. I want to hold this this accountable and find out what's going on here. And I think you guys need to find this out too. It may just be something about the way I'm listening with guitar soloed, or I don't know, something I'm doing wrong that leads me to keep on needing bitier instruments, and that allows me to record guitars that need EQ like this. That's unbelievable to me. I can't believe I did that. And I'm not new to this. So anyway, guys, that was my big old rant on what I'm going to call the Aerosmith effect.